I think we'd probably better make a start, as we've got until about 2:45. And what I'd like to do is to have plenty of time for you to share some perspectives with one another, not just for me to be talking. So we shall have a roving microphone for some discussion. And what I'll do is offer a few thoughts to start with, about 20 minutes worth, invite you to talk to one another for a few minutes, and then share what you'd like to share. I apologize for the temperature in here, which is a bit punishing. And the atmosphere is just a little bit stark. I said to the earlier group, it's rather like the place where you find the bodies in some of those television detective serials. But at least the lights are on. But let's talk a bit then about when the going gets rough. I'm taking it for granted that for most people in this hall, there will have been times, there will be times, and there will still be times when praying doesn't seem to deliver the goods, and when we're aware of brick walls, dead ends, a sense of energy running out, or even worse, a sense that we're sort of left in midair, that we don't quite know what's going on any longer. Once upon a time, it was all right. We look back on a very positive experience, maybe an experience of coming to faith, a decisive experience in moving forward in faith, and then we ask, what happened to that? Once it was all right, and now it isn't. And talking about this, of course, is not just a modern 21st century thing. Right through the history of the Christian Church, we have the chronicles, we have the records of people who have clearly been through this kind of experience, or non-experience, or negative experience. And they include some spectacularly great Christian figures. John Wesley is somebody that we regularly associate with extremely positive, outgoing, confident Christian witness and mission. And yet, one of Wesley's greatest sermons is entitled The Wilderness Experience. The Wilderness Experience. And it's precisely dealing with what happens when you, as it were, come down from the clouds after your positive times. Wesley, remember, had this wonderful conversion experience. I felt my heart strangely warmed. And then within a few years, he felt his heart strangely chilled. And he writes about that sense of being out there on your own. Even as late as the 1760s, when he was getting to be quite an old gentleman, he could write in a letter to his brother that looking back on his ministry, he sometimes had a sense that he'd never really known God at all. It's very moving. He says, looking back, it just seems I've always been on the outside. I've never really cracked it. I've been as close to God as a relatively decent pagan might be, no more than that. And then he says wonderfully, and yet to be so employed of God. He knew that although he couldn't see it or feel it, he'd been used. And that suggests to me that there had been long periods of real sterility and darkness and difficulty in Wesley's life. More recently, of course, when Mother Teresa of Calcutta died, she left behind journals and letters and meditations, which made it very clear that she, one of the greatest Christian icons of the age, had spent decades, not just years, but decades, with a deeply negative, empty, dry, sterile life of prayer. And when you think of what she achieved and what sort of person she was, how people saw God coming through her, it's really quite startling to think that she couldn't see or feel any of that. And there's a line in, I think it's a letter of Cardinal Newman, where he says that sometimes your soul is like a burning glass. It transmits heat elsewhere, but it's cold itself. So, obviously very pertinent for us this afternoon as we huddle into our jackets. But The point is that this is something which Christians throughout the ages have been very bitterly aware of. Sometimes it's expressed in the language of protest. People like Luther, who was never a man to be backward in showing his emotions, will say, and it's quite all right to shout at God sometimes. In a much more polite and Anglican way, the great George Herbert, in his poetry, spells out what it's like to feel that you've wasted your life, you've wasted your energy, it doesn't really mean very much. And those of you who know Herbert's poems will recognize several of the most powerful of them are really saying, what am I doing? And for Herbert, you know, I gave up a very promising career to get ordained. I turned my back on the university and the court. I led an exemplary life, and look where it's got me. Here I am, twiddling my thumbs in a country parish, frankly not knowing what to do next or what it's all about. And as for the God who so seemed to speak to me in sweetness and light and beauty, can't see him anywhere. So if you are experiencing those dry and sterile times, it helps just for a start to know that you're not the first, and that among those who've been there before you are people of enormous spiritual depth and stature who've made a real difference. So what's going on in all this? One of the most sophisticated and interesting analysts of all this is, of course, the great 16th century Spanish writer, St. John of the Cross, who first coins the phrase, the dark night of the soul. And the dark night of the soul, for St. John, isn't just a period where you're feeling a bit glum or things aren't going brilliantly well. It's a much more intense sense of loss. Once it was all right and now it isn't. And what's it all about? And I can't get it back. And St. John gives us, I think, an unparalleled analysis of this, of what's going on in this state of mind, this state of soul. And his analysis is basically this. God wants to be God. And God, you might say, can't help being God. And because God is really God, God can't just coexist with the funny little pictures of God we have in our minds. Sooner or later, one of them's got to go. Either the real God settles in and pushes away those strange little myths and images we have of him, or we let the myths and images blossom and flourish and push the real God out. But in that process, of course, there's a lot of pain, a lot of uncertainty involved. Because letting go of the pictures of God that I really cherish and love is extremely hard work. I may feel that my whole self, my whole value, is invested in these particular pictures of God. But God wants to be God, and God can't help being God. And if there's even the smallest corner in my soul that's open to the real God, then that reality is gradually going to squeeze out the falsehoods, the idols that we have. The going gets rough, partly because God can't help being God. That's one thing to hang on to, I think. It's the godness of God that's the problem. It's not just my own failure, my own weakness, though that, that helps. So that, of course, does suggest that if somebody you know, including yourself, is having a bad period and not radiating spiritual joy in the way you think they ought to be, don't panic and don't condemn. Don't say, well, it must be your fault. Try harder. And that's, as we'll see in a little bit, one of the most important messages that we can have to give to one another. Because that's where the life of the body of Christ kicks in. What we have to do for each other, very importantly, is not to undermine, to intensify people's self-doubt or guilt, but to try and hang on in those times when it's dark. Hang on to them, hang on to ourselves, and hang on to the things that just keep us going. The things that just keep us going. Because when our feelings and our pictures, our hopes and our imaginings are fading away or seem a bit stale or a bit tired, when we're not sensing the excitement, and to use a word I hate, vibrancy of our faith, could somebody please make the word vibrant illegal? It conjures up all sorts of strange pictures to my mind. If that's not working as we think it ought to be working, we're going to need handholds and five-finger exercises, the things that just keep us in touch and allow something to come through even when we're not feeling like it. In the last of these sessions, somebody came up with a wonderful image about this. He said that he'd once been told that saying morning prayer could be like getting on a very uncomfortable commuter train. You didn't feel much like it, you didn't enjoy the experience very much, but by gum, it got you to work. And I think there's a great deal in that. So that one of the challenges for us in coming to terms with the rough and difficult times is, what are the structures, what are the patterns that have enough resourcefulness to keep us going? That's why the church has traditionally emphasized the daily office. That's why people's rule of life becomes important. And a rule of life is tested and tried, not when you're feeling wonderful and pious, but when you're feeling bored, tired, and cynical. And you know that you have actually made a commitment to give 15 minutes before you go to bed to reading some scripture and saying a psalm or two, and you've just got to do it. Eating your greens, you know, you're keeping in touch. And quite a bit of the time, that can be how it is. Because if we expect our lives of prayer always to be radiant and wonderful and exciting and different, we're in, first of all, for quite a lot of disillusion and disappointment, because, you know, human life just is a bit more complicated than that. And we're also potentially in for a career of beating ourselves up because we're not doing well enough, let alone making other people's lives difficult when they're not up to scratch. One 20th century Catholic writer, John Chapman, who wrote some of the most wonderful letters on the life of prayer in the English language, said that there are only two things you need to know about difficult times in prayer. One is, pray as you can, don't try to pray as you can't. And the second is, the less you pray, the worse it gets. He said, that's all you really need to know. Pray as you can, don't try to pray as you can't. That is, find what works. Find the structures and patterns that just keep you going. It's not going to be the same for everybody. And again, there's absolutely no cause to go around browbeating everyone else to do the same thing as you. But the pattern, the discipline, the rule is potentially life-giving. It keeps you going, a series of handholds. It may not feel exciting, it may not be getting much traction, but you're going to need it. And the second thing, the less you pray, the worse it gets. Because the less you give time to the reality of God to impinge on you, the more tight a hold on you some of your fantasies and images and mythologies will get. It's as if you're never allowing God to get at you and your rather selfish and rather muddled inner life. So the less you pray, the worse it gets. Sound advice. But I would put in one, not a third recommendation, but a perspective within which to see all of that. And that's what I've hinted at already. The perspective of the body of Christ. What are we going to do for each other when the going gets rough? Because there are some bits of spiritual advice and styles of spiritual advice which can, no doubt unwittingly, suggest that it's really just my problem. But it ought to be a problem that we share. When things are difficult, we ought to be able to say to our fellow Christians, look, I'm going through a pretty bleak patch. hang on for me, will you? And hang on with me, and hang on to me. That's the body of Christ at work. And that's why the worst thing we can possibly do for each other is to say, you know, get your act together. Why aren't you more cheerful? Christians should be radiant and faithful and wonderful, and you're glum and boring. So, come on. You don't need me to tell you that there are some Christian contexts where the pressure is on to what I sometimes think of as the sparkling teeth of perfect faith radiating at you from all directions. And one of the simplest bits of advice you can give about when the going gets rough is don't be surprised, don't panic. It happens. It happens to people in all kinds of contexts, all kinds of spiritual maturity. It happens. And it's all right. You can be honest about it. You mustn't be ashamed about it. And you mustn't delude yourself that it's all fine. But what you can do is to reach out to somebody else and say, as I put it, hang on for me and with me and to me. Hang on for me, I say to another Christian. I can't make much sense of it, but maybe you can. And I'm going to look to you for some faithfulness and some help. I'm going to look to you to show me a bit of what God's like, to show me a faithfulness and a generosity that reminds me of the God I'm supposed to believe in. Hang on with me. Let me know that we belong together in a shared journey. Share your experience with me too. And please, hang on to me. Say prayers for me. Be a listening ear. And that, I think, is very near the heart of how we cope with and how we respond to the rough times, the bleak times, our service to our ministry to each other, our being Christ for and to one another. And we mustn't be ashamed of putting it as bluntly as that, our being Christ to and for one another. So, in dealing with these times when we're not making much sense to ourselves, where we don't quite know even if we believe or not, but we can't just walk away, we need both those basic routines that keep us in touch, what I call the eating our greens side of it, and we need the affirming, praying presence of our brothers and sisters. And, of course, as St. Paul indicates in 2 Corinthians, when out of my poverty I ask something from somebody else's treasure, that's also a promise that when I feel there's treasure rising in me, I'm able to give it into the poverty of another. We don't, as I said this morning, we don't live or die alone as praying persons. We are always feeding one another in the church. And in these times of difficulty, that feeding has a great deal to do with showing faithfulness, generosity, being there, being with, holding on. The promise of rough and dark times is really the promise contained in St. John of the Cross's analysis, that at the end of the day, this is something to do with becoming more truthful, becoming more real. Instead of the very finest and most sophisticated God we could invent for ourselves, we have the real God, who is actually rather better. Our temptation will be always to think we could do the job better and think up a God who, because he fits into our preconceptions and meets our needs, is doing a much better job than the real one. Well, dream on, as they say. But the promise of this is if God really is crunching up and pushing out and pushing away the false pictures, what lies on the far side of it is reality, truth, and life. And that's why St. John of the Cross can say in one of his memorable images, remember, it gets really dark at midnight, which is just the point before it starts moving towards the dawn. And as one of my friends once said, the great thing about St. John of the Cross is that he says, the worse it gets, the better it gets. And there is something in that. If you really do feel you're losing your way, and the pictures and the images and the easy things are no longer there. Well, you might try saying thank you, simply because that might well be an indication that the reality of God is just slowly pushing out the comfortable fantasies that we'd prefer to have. Well, what I'd like us to do in the time that's left is, first of all, to talk to our neighbours for 3 to 5 minutes about any immediate reactions you have to that or points you'd like to raise. It may help you to shape up a question or a comment you want to make. And I was very struck and very glad this morning that in the earlier workshop session, people were genuinely able to speak to one another in this context. I don't think workshop is another name for lecture. It's, you know, we're doing something with each other, I hope. So a little bit of talk to one another, and then we should have up to 20 minutes, I hope, for some interchange. So would you like just to exchange any thoughts you have on the basis of all that? Thank you.